We're at the TC3 conference. We're with Mike Leber, founder, owner of Hurricane Electric. Many of you have probably heard of Hurricane Electric. Well, I had the opportunity to meet him about 20 years ago or so. I think it was in the Gold Building in a little room. Why don't you talk a little bit about what Hurricane Electric does, and we'll go into conversation about how you've gone from that little room to worldwide.
Hurricane Electric operates a global backbone. We started out in 94, it's 20 years ago, or actually a little more than 20 years ago now. And basically what was happening is the Mozilla had hit about 93, and we'd been doing consulting for companies to be able to use internet technologies, local area network type things, to be able to do print bureaus and that kind of thing. And what happened was we ended up deciding that, hey, actually being a service provider is a better business than doing consulting, because frequently clients would have to decide complicated decisions about whether or not to build a network or follow any, you know, set up servers, etc. It's all very complex, and we were the experts. And at one point I had an epiphany of it would be a better business to actually do this than to talk about it. So then we ended up starting, and I'd been aware of local area networks and the internet, setting up local area networks at the high-tech companies I'd been working at for a number of years as a software engineer before that. So in 89, I'd actually tried to get a connection to the internet, but it was pre-commercial, sort of where it was still sort of the NSFnet days, where you couldn't necessarily buy a commercial connection, and people would say, oh no, you have to be affiliated with a research institution. Anyway, what happened was in 94, I actually set up routers and got servers going, and we ended up getting a connection. And then what happened is I read everything about the core, the internet, and BGP, and then knew what business I wanted to get into. It's kind of a strange thing where you end up picking something where you have a kind of a life calling where you're like, okay, I definitely want to do this kind of thing. I want to provide connectivity for networks. But what happened is we started expanding in the U.S. We expanded to, there was a big exchanges called May West and May East, and we expanded. First, we were at May West, then we expanded to Pax Palo Alto, and then we expanded to May East over to 8100 Boone in Virginia. And then progressively as time went on, then we expanded to London and so on. What we do as a business is we provide connectivity to networks. So our customers are the telecoms, cable MSOs, mobile providers in different areas, as well as enterprises and institutional networks. So for example, a city might have a network, or the educational, there might be a research and educational network in a state or a particular province or whatnot. And those are our target customers. There's about 51,000 networks in the world, and 51,000 networks in the world that are potential, you know, that run BGP, that are at the core of the internet, and they all buy service from internet backbones. Somebody is their upstream somewhere, and the internet backbones interconnect with each other. Hurricane Electric operates one of the global internet backbones. Right now we have over 14,000 BGP sessions with over 4,000 networks in North America, Europe, and Asia, and we're the first network in the world to connect to over 100 different internet exchanges, and we continue to add them at a rapid pace, basically because none of our competitors or other, you know, the other participants in the market are sitting still either. So it's definitely a thing where there's no letting up. We just keep expanding. Currently, with the most recent expansions we're undertaking right now, we'll be in 30 countries. To give an example of some recent activity, we added Finland, Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania. And then in addition to that, we also signed recently for Hawaii. So I just added Honolulu.
Nice. And one of the things I know a lot of my rural friends know you guys, because you actually are in quite a few rural pops as well.
So, yes, absolutely. So we expanded to Omaha. We also are in Madison, Wisconsin. And in addition to that, we're in one of the few networks in Canada to have a fully Canadian path all the way across Canada. So we basically can go from Vancouver to Calgary to Winnipeg, across over the Great Lakes on the top side to Toronto, and then to Montreal. So that's, even for Canadian networks, there's not too many that have a network all the way across that can do that. And the latency is good. It's not a slower path. It's actually a fast path from Montreal all the way across. In addition to that, we recently, just in the last couple months, expanded to Saskatchewan and to Edmonton. So that's like kind of going north there.
What's really cool, though, is you've managed to do this through some tumultuous times. I mean, you had the dot-com crash. You know, how did you grow the company?
Well, it's a kind of a really interesting and crazy business. So we didn't take on outside investors because there's an interesting problem in the IP business. So in telecom, there's a wide range of different sources of revenue. A lot of the carriers out there make a substantial portion of their revenue from wavelengths. Some may do packet services like transport, layer 2 transport. Others do various other managed services. And then there's the internet service. And more specifically, at the core of the internet, there's IP transit. So we're a specialist at providing IP transit. And so one of the ways that we gain an advantage is that we were early adopter of IPv6. So we've supported, I was aware of IPv6 since in the 90s because there was discussions about it that eventually IPv4 would run out. And now Aaron has actually run out of IPv4. I think everybody's heard that announcement. But way back then, in 2001, we set up a test. Every year we have various R&D projects. And in 2001, we set up one of our five different major R&D initiatives was to deploy an IPv6 network, and I coded up a tunnel broker. And so it's a bit since rewritten many different times by other people, but initially I coded up something in Perl and whatnot and set it up so that people could actually manually configure what's called a 6-to-4 or 6-in-4 tunnel, where basically what happened is they could do test IPv6 over their existing IPv4 connection if they had the right configuration on their server or workstation. So and that was made for developers, software engineers, network engineers, and system administrators, so that they could experiment with V6, because native V6 wasn't available back then. You sort of have to bootstrap. So that was done early on. We ended up accumulating eventually 500,000 users on that platform. It's a free platform, so it's a V6 certification, tunnel broker, free dual stack DNS. Originally, there wasn't anybody doing dual stack IPv4 and IPv6 DNS, where you'd have native at wire speed, both be able to handle both V6 and V4 records. And so we were an early platform for doing that. We just did it as a public service. So that ended up accumulating a lot of critical mass, and also there's a thing of getting thought leadership. So basically it enabled us to have something that we do that's unique and different. So and the other thing is, a lot of telecom monopolies have no upside to trying to do a new protocol before they actually know it's needed. If you're a manager, especially a business manager in a company, and you're not an engineer, you're not intimately involved with deployment of the different technologies, you're not going to have any kind of way of deciding one project versus another. They're all just words. So at the end of the day, the thing that would be meaningful to you is when it actually starts having a return on investment. But the problem with IPv6 is it's a thing to solve a problem that happens in the future. So nobody could know that what was going to be the situation. So we started doing IPv6 very early on, and did the same kind of aggressive deployment as we do with the IPv4. And because we were the only people that showed up for a race, a track race, and we took 20 laps around the race around the track before any other contestants showed up. And so that's one of the ways that we're currently the largest IPv6 network in the world by number of networks connected, and as well as by number of customer prefixes announced.
Well, it makes sense, Mike, because where I met you, you were right in the thick of things, actually doing the work, and I think that's the big difference, is you actually do a lot of this work, and you know what's needed, so you're very close to the customer. So it's been great catching up with you.
Thank you.